Welkom luisteraars bij Bluesmoose Radio, hier vanuit de studio's van Omroep Groesbeek, waar we natuurlijk ook te luisteren zijn bij onze collega's bij Uniek FM en bij Nima.nu. Maar natuurlijk ook in Nijmegen, land van Maas en Waal en eigenlijk overal waar u een computer heeft. Want op internet zijn we een van de best beluisterde radiostations van de wereld, althans via iTunes. Nou, dat wil toch wel wat zeggen. En we hebben een speciale uitzending, want de gast van vandaag in de studio is Michael Katon. Michael, welcome to Bluesmoose Radio.
Hey man, it's glad to be here.
Yeah, well, it's a long time. We had it in our... would you have as a guest a long, long time ago, but finally is so far. And it's a good way, because you have your acoustic... guitar. We provide an acoustic guitar with
you. Yeah, you sure do.
And we're going to have a small talk about Mike and Katon, who he is, and in between you're going to play some songs, whatever's coming up for you. So, first of all, you did an acoustic gig last night.
Yeah, we sure did.
That's not something you're expecting from Michael Katon, who's the boogeyman from hell, and has his amp provided with dials who go to 12, he told me.
You know what, man? Actually, the original song... Man from Hell is acoustic on the record, man. The Rub CD.
Okay.
You remember that one?
That's
that was a long time ago. You're probably
90s.
Too young to remember that
the
one.
The early man. 90s, was that?
Yeah, no. Probably something like that. Yeah.
93, if I'm correct. So I did a little bit of homework. But
I do some acoustic once in a while, man. I like it at home, you know. That's all I play at home. I don't even pull my guitars out of the case unless I'm recording or something, you know. But, I mean, the electric ones.
Isn't it so that a song... to be good, it has to be good acoustic and...
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's true. You know, you should be able to whistle a song and it'll be good, you know. Songwriters have a thing they call it, if it passes the whistle test, you know, then it's a good song. But most of my songs don't pass that test, so I have to play the guitar, man.
Maybe it's because if the audience was at a venue, the ears were whistling after you were gone.
Yeah, that's true. Mine are whistling right now, brother, I'll tell you that.
Well, give us a shout to the first one.
Well, you said you like that barbecue on my boogie,
yeah.
Right?
We have a bad, bad winter. No snow, just rain. It's barbecue weather here.
Yeah, barbecue. Well, I like a little barbecue on everything, man, especially my boogie. Let me see. See if I can sing today, man. Like a little barbecue on my boogie. Little hot sauce on the side. I like a little barbecue on my boogie. Little hot sauce on the side. And when my baby lets me lick her little jalapeno, good Lord, I get satisfied. My little girl's red hot cooking. Woo! It's gonna make you come running home. Yeah. My little girl's red hot cooking. Good Lord, it's gonna make you come running on home. She rubbed that barbecue all over my boogie. Hot sauce all up and down my ice cream cone. You can't taste her cooking without losing your mind. She got a hot tamale, fellas. Send lightning bolts down your spine. I said, my little girl's red hot cooking. Good Lord, it's gonna make you come running home. She rubbed that barbecue all over my boogie. Yes, she does. Hot sauce all up and down my ice cream cone. Barbecue on that one, man. Yeah, you can't taste her cooking without losing your mind. She got a couple enchiladas, man. Send lightning bolts down your spine. I said, my little girl's red hot cooking. Man, it's gonna make you come running home. She rubbed that barbecue all over my boogie. Yeah, she spreads that hot sauce all on my ice cream cone. Hey, that's a good Saturday song.
Yeah, and it's a good blues song. There's a lot of innuendo going on in that song.
Yeah, well, it's the truth, man.
is that a recipe for a good song, a blues song? It has to be something from real life. And then,
sex and food.
And then some innuendo about it.
Yeah, that's it, man.
What's the best blues lyric ever written by you?
By me?
Well, you say that's the one I'm proud of.
Oh,
that I was in a good spirit then.
Man, I couldn't tell you that. Let me see. I'll do a song here about Son House playing this thing last or something, man? Maybe I don't know if I use a slide or not. I might have to reach over here and grab it, man. Remember this one? In the evil hours, when no daylight can be found, in the evil hours, when no daylight can be found, yeah, when that blue moon shines, the devil's daughter comes creeping round. Yeah, she's a burning flame, fellas. She will mesmerize your mind. Well, there goes one of the strings. Yeah, she's a burning flame. She will mesmerize your mind. She put a craving on your soul, fam. You ain't gonna shake till the end of time. Watch her now, here she come. Even when you beg and plead, man, she ain't gonna have no mercy. Even when you beg and plead, cause it gives her heart pleasure. Yeah, watching your heart bleed. She's the devil's daughter, man. wait a minute. There is still a string on here. It just popped off. I wish I would have known that. I thought it was broke, man.
Well, huh? That's the blues. That's the blues. Let's put it that way.
Woo. There we go.
Hey, Michael, you started out. I read in your bio that your parents were pretty supportive in picking up an instrument.
Well, what happened, man, my brother was a drummer. My older brother, he's like 7 years older than me, and he was already playing in bands and stuff, and I wanted to be a drummer. But my mother and dad had enough of the pounding drums in the house for my brother, so they said, well, that's too loud. So I played a trumpet in school, you know, since I was like 10 years old.
In a marching band. That would be
a sight. Yeah, I was in junior high school. Yeah, in high school I was in a marching band, man. Tell you the truth, man, I didn't mind that. Anything organized like that, you know, like I don't like being a part of, really. I'm not too organized, you know. But marching down the street with a fucking drum line behind you. Can I swear on the fucking radio?
Yeah, no problem with you.
But marching down the street with a drum line behind you, you know, about 5 bass drums and, you know, 20 snare drums and all that, and you're just marching in a cadence, and the drummers used to come up with some cool cadences, you know. I mean, it's really quite thrilling. It really is, man, the beat of it and all that noise, you know.
You didn't do the stadium walks?
I've been in stadiums playing in, the University of Michigan Stadium. They used to have a thing there called Band Day where all the marching bands came and played at the halftime at the football game.
Yeah,
so there'd be like 100 marching bands on the field, and they would, you know, all play like the Stars and Stripes Forever and these patriotic songs, you know?
Yeah, and they have a competition between who does.
Da 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 da. You know, John Philip Sousa songs and stuff like that.
That would be a good offer if you walk on stage with a marching band and then Michael Katon is coming out with a boogie.
Guitar army. Man, but the cool thing was, like, when they rehearsed, like in the afternoon before the game started, they'd have a rehearsal, man. So the conductors, they had 2 or 3 of them on big ladders, man, so everybody could see them. And they'd, like, practice, like, cymbal crashes or bass drum hits. You know, a guy going like that, and boom, and then just like thunder, man. But it was very cool, man. I'm glad I did it.
Did he also provide you with an education on the trumpet, so music?
Ah, man, they didn't teach me nothing about music, man. Nah.
Who teach you? Who teach you the guitar?
Different guys, man, through the ages, like a song like that I just played, man. It was this old black dude, man. When I was a kid, I ran into him in the music store, man. And, you know, he came in asking for, I was working at a music store when I was a kid, you know, selling guitar strings and stuff. And the guy came in, man, this old black cat, and he says, man, I need me a wire for my guitar, you know, and he's got this old Stella. You know, like they used to use, you know, like, you know, Son House and those guys would be using these kind of guitars. And so he has this guitar, and I put the string on. What kind do you want, man? I want a black diamond, which is the only kind of strings we used to be able to get when we were kids, you know. They're really cheap. And so I put the string on for him. I tune it up, and I hit a couple licks, you know. And he goes, oh, man, I want to learn to play like that, you know. I said, oh, you play a little bit? Nah, I just kind of play some old country stuff, man. I said, what do you mean, man, country stuff? He said, from Mississippi, man, where I'm from, you know.
Okay.
He was from Laurel, Mississippi. And I said, well, hit us a lick, man. You know, what do you want to learn, man? So he was doing this stuff. It was really hard to, like that old Muddy Water stuff, you know. He starts hitting his, and I go, wow, that's cool, man. Yeah, that's what we play, man, you know, down where I come from. So, and he started, he was so deep from the South, like there's all this racism and prejudice and stuff. So he was afraid. He was in the store, there were some people, he was playing this blues stuff, and some people started gathering around. And then he goes, well, I'm going to pull out my knife. So he gets up like this, said, "Now don't nobody call the police." He says, "I'm gonna pull out my knife." So he pulls out his knife like this. And he says, "Don't call the police. I'm not gonna hurt anybody, you know." And he takes his knife and he holds it like that, you know. And he was holding it like that, playing slide, you know. And so that was kind of cool. I learned some slide stuff like that. Like if you're missing a slide, he held it like this. He kind of held it like that, you know.
Never seen that before. For the record, was that a colored guy or was he a white guy?
Yeah, heard? Black guy, yeah. Old John Smith, man. He do. But I heard... I heard Blind Willie Johnson played with a knife underneath like this, you know? You know, like this kind of thing. You know, like that kind of stuff. You know?
What knives good for?
You know, with a knife.
Yeah.
And sometimes you can hear it, man, on those old Blind Willie Johnson records, like... Or some people say, like, you use, like, a screwdriver or something. Or sometimes they'd be over the top like this, you know. But he'd be doing that just to that one modal kind of a...
I think you had a knife easy on the pocket than a bottleneck or something like that.
Well,
tube.
I mean, I use the...
That's the nice thing about a bottleneck. It makes it more melancholic. It's more pain in the song.
Well, some people don't realize the material all this stuff is made of. Can you see all the dents and cuts in there?
I see it.
That's like really soft brass. And these are handmade for me, but the old blues cats, man, they were just cutting off hunks of pipe and stuff. I had a chance to talk to Robert Jr. Lockwood one time, man. And, you know, Robert Johnson's kind of stepson, the story goes.
Yeah.
And I asked him, man, I said, "What did Robert Johnson use, man, for a slide and stuff like that?" He says, something metal, you know.
Something metal.
Because everybody thinks they were using old bottlenecks and stuff, you know. But, like Muddy Waters, he had a slide that was only about like this long, you know.
That's a short one.
But yes. Robert Johnson, he would do like some of my stuff on, what record is this on? I think a live, Busting Up the Joint Live. Robert Johnson had that song.
Yeah.
I said the blues. It's a low-down stinking jam. You know? Anyway, so I just steal the music and I come up with... "Come right down to my level, honey, we can rock around, we can rock around. Come right down to my level, honey, we can rock around, we can rock around. Come right down to my level, honey," said. Just like the bar, man. People crawling around. "We can do it in the kitchen, we can do it in the hall, we can rock around, we can rock around. We can do it in the kitchen, we can do it in the hall, we can rock around, we can rock around. We can do it in the kitchen, we can do it in the hall, baby, sir. We can rock around." We can do it in the kitchen, we can do it in the hall, we can rock around, we can rock around. like you're doing in the hall. We can rock around, we can rock around. Do this to get you, we can do it in the hall.
Hey, cool.
Hey, thank you.
Hey, show of hands of the audience.
Yeah.
And then you started playing in about around Detroit, Michigan.
Yeah, I grew up in a town called Ypsilante, Michigan.
Ypsilante.
Which is a strange Greek name.
Yes, it is.
They named it after, there was a general, there were some wars going on in Greece, like in the 1800s, sometime whenever they named the town.
Still.
Yeah, and he was kind of a famous general or something, this General Ypsilantius or something like that.
Well, if you stupid names for a town, America is the leading country about that.
But it's a factory town, man. It's kind of like blue, a mini Detroit, really.
Blue collar.
Yeah, real blue collar, man. Half the town was, there was kind of a dividing line back in those days. The black side of town would live on, you know, there'd almost be a dividing line with the street, you know. And they, all the black folks lived on the south side, you know, and the hillbillies and stuff where I grew up lived on the east side. And then the rich people lived on the west side. So,
the cold people lived on the north side.
Yeah. But all the people I see, they got what they call like, rebels and Yankees or whatever. You're from the north, you were a Yankee, and if you're from the south, you were a rebel, right? So anyway, I was the only Yankee on my block, the only northern person. Everybody else was from the south, and what happened, they came up to work in the automobile factories, like during World War II especially, to find work because there wasn't any work in the south. So and they built these project, you know, little houses around the factories, you know, where all these people could live. And that's kind of where I grew up, in one of those small houses that every house looks the same, you know, and it's a tiny little house. I think my dad told me he paid $10,000 for the house, man, you know. So anyway, that's where I grew up, and it was all factory workers. Like when you were in high school, you know, hey man, what you gonna do when you graduate? Well, I'm gonna go out to the plant and get a job, man. You know, and that's what everybody did. And but all this music was a lot of country music, man. Real country influence. Like I remember my dad every Saturday morning would have the country station on. You know, like
the Grand Ole Opry, the shows.
Yeah. Yeah. You know what I mean? What you got cooking?
What happened then? Because you picked the right kind of music for our loving, so you have to be. If everybody's listening country, how came Michael Katon picking up the blues and blues rock?
Well, I'll tell you what happened. Like I said, my older brother was a drummer in a band, and they were already out playing gigs, man. And then he left home. He was like I said, 7 years older than me. So he left home, and he was out on his own. He got with a blues band called the Prime Movers Blues Band. And maybe this guitar of Mag Joe over here might know Dan Erlewine. Have you ever heard of Dan Erlewine? He's a guitar luthier now. Real famous in the States. He writes for like Guitar Player magazine, and he's got videos and stuff on guitar repair and stuff. But back in the old days, he was a hell of a blues guitar player.
Okay.
Like kind of like Stevie Ray Vaughan or something back in 1965, you know. And he was hanging out with Paul Butterfield Blues Band and all these people, and Alvin Bishop and Mike Bloomfield.
Okay.
And
Elton is still around.
So, yeah. So what happened was my brother had left home, and I was starting to play. And my brother sometimes would say, hey, he'd ask my mom and dad, hey, can Mike come with me and spend the weekend, you know? So they thought, oh, that'd be nice with big brother, you know, spending the weekend. And They just thought we were going to museums or something, you know. Or, but anyway, my brother was doing these gigs and taking me with him on these blues gigs, like some of them till 5 in the morning, man. And sometimes they'd have these blind pig things where it'd be like from 1 in the morning till 5 in the morning. You have to knock on the door and they'd look out and let you in. And, but it'd be all these blues bands. And Dan Erlewine was building guitars for, if you saw Albert King, like the last, you know, 20 years of his life, he was playing this mahogany dark wood flying V,
yeah,
with his name down the front. Well, I watched that being built because Dan Erlewine, I used to go to his shop and he'd show me some guitar and stuff. And he was building that guitar at that point. He built that out of an old piano wood, is what he told me, from what I remember.
And then lay in the name with, yeah, with some...
But all the wood out of that was from an old 100-year-old piano. And he built that for Albert King. And like when he was doing the inlays for his name, you know, I was there, in there. I'd be in there every week, you know, to see him once a week. And it was in different stages. But when he was doing the inlays, I was rubbing my fingers on it. You know, it's like I thought, you know, 30 years later, I'll see a picture and know that I did that, which is, you know, what happened. But anyway, so my brother's playing these gigs with Dan Erlewine and the Prime Movers Blues Band. And I didn't know, but they were out doing some pretty big gigs, man. And so Danny asked me, he goes, well, what are you listening to, man? You know, I said, well, it must have been 1966, and the Cream had just come out. And I just got turned on to the Cream, you know. So I'm reading the back of the album, and it says this Eric Clapton guy, you know. So he goes, well, what are you listening to, man? And I go, well, I kind of like this band, the Cream. And there's a guy named Eric Clapton, you know. I like the way he plays. And he goes, well, yeah, he's cool. Well, it turns out my brother and them had been opening up gigs with the Cream when they were around Detroit, you know. And and Danny goes, well, you should really, you know, Eric Clapton is very cool, but you should listen to who he listened to. Yeah. And I say, yeah, who's that? And he goes, well, man, like Freddie King and Albert King, BB, Elmore James, Otis Rush, yep, you know. So I went and got all those records that he told me about. And because this one music store was right on the borderline of the black section of town. And so they had all the blues records for the black folks,
okay,
in town.
Of course.
And you could buy them for a dollar. Like all the BB King, I got a stack of BB King records a meter high, man. Every one I got, and I bought them for like $1. And I had a paper out then delivering paper, so I'd save my money and buy these records. But all the old stuff on Kent Records, you know, and all that stuff, all the old BB King stuff. And they'd have people like Freddie King and Elmore James and, oh God, Lowell Fulsom, T-Bone Walker, John Lee Hooker, all those guys you could buy for a buck, you know, the album.
That's what they say. They say we were inspired by the old blues guys.
Yeah.
And they brought the blues back to America, as they,
yeah,
say. That's what we listened first to Stevie Ray Vaughan like that. And yeah, later I discovered that he had a lot of...
Well, you know what it is? It's funny. When I first kind of started making records and I'd be coming to England and stuff, and then over here in the early 90s, and then... Way earlier than that, in the 80s, I was coming to England, and they were putting my records out. And I'd get a review, and they'd say, oh, he's like influenced by Stevie Ray Vaughan. And I'm going, nah, I never heard of Stevie Ray Vaughan, you know. But I just, you know, we listened to Albert King, you know, is where that came from.
Yeah.
So, but I did actually get, I did get to see Stevie Ray Vaughan in the early days, man, which was quite a treat. And I got to meet him and stuff. And but he was still walking out, setting his own amps up, you know, and taking them down. And real nice guy, man. I was, you know, he was walking out of this place, and I said, "Hey, man, how you doing? Yeah. You know, pleased to meet you." And he's very, very nice cat, man. Really.
Well,
nice.
His last gig was with Eric Clapton.
Yeah, and his brother's nice too, man.
Jimmy, yeah, still
Jimmy's
is
real nice, man.
Still is. But back to you. One intriguing fact I read on your Facebook that you said, I did my albums, I did a lot of them, I still do make albums, but I don't put them on CD anymore.
Yeah, man. I mean, I got two brand new CDs, man.
But in Urbia, I get CDs, but you don't put them out in CD. You can download them. It's because nowadays the whole music industry changes.
Well, yeah, I mean,
maybe you're fed up with some record companies.
No. What it is it, I have my own record label. It's called Wild Ass Records. And it's under an umbrella called MAG Productions. And I licensed my albums out, you know, in the past, like over here in Europe, around Provoke Records quite a bit, and some other record labels, way in the early days, Loop and Link Records, and there was a Garage Land Records out of Sweden, and some other ones I can't recall. Anyway, I just, you know, it costs a lot of money to manufacture your own CDs. And you stick them out, and then, like, we were on tour a few years back, and my bass player came up and said, "Hey, man, look at the CD I just bought." And it was, like, manufactured in Moscow, you know? And I'm going, well, I didn't license anything in Russia. And nobody else, you know, any of these other records never sub-licensed anything, man. So it's like you spend all this money, and you put it out, and it's out for downloads the next day, you know? And I used to go like on the Pirate Bay and stuff and see that, man. I mean, I probably lost $50,000-$75,000 on different albums just from people not buying them. But it doesn't matter nowadays because they have like, what you know, these streaming services like Spotify is a big one. And, you know, even Google streaming and Amazon. And
iTunes.
Yeah, iTunes and all that. But I'm thinking pretty soon there won't even be iTunes, you know, in another 5 years. But it's all going to be streaming, you know, and to me it's convenient. I mean, if I showed you I was listening to my own songs here coming over on Spotify because I was thinking I had some stuff in my head and I hadn't played for a while. And, you know, so I'm listening to my own stuff on Spotify. But, you know, a lot of these bigger stars and stuff, they made deals with these record labels years and years ago to where they're just getting fractions of pennies anyway. And, but a long time ago, I kind of made a wise move, and I retained all my rights for everything. Okay. And all my digital rights I own, 100%. So, like, when I stick something out, like Spotify, I make money from Spotify. You know, every time somebody listens to one of my tunes, I'm making money. And there's a lot of people in the news, you know, they're bitching about Spotify. Oh, they cheat the artist, blah, 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 blah. Well, that's just because they were too stupid to retain their rights, you know. They signed them away, which may not make them stupid or not. I mean, I did some things like that in the past, you know, myself. But I got fucked really bad one time, and I started studying music law, you know, years and years ago, like way in the early 90s.
Maybe every musician should be taught law.
Well, yeah, they should, man, because these guys are like sharks out there, man, you know. They don't care about anything but the money. So anyway, I learned all the law and the tricks and the inside stuff, and I retained all my rights to everything, so I own everything. And I, you know, like I recorded that Blue Tooth album. It's all blues covers. And what I had to do is all the administration, where I got to find all the copyright owners, I got to pay them money for every one I sell. You know, digitally, I can prepay, you know, ahead of time for what I anticipate streaming or selling. But it's a real pain in the ass, man. And it's like when I record my own music, it comes right to me. I don't have to do any paperwork or anything. But when you're recording other people's tunes, the reason I did that Bluetooth album is just to kind of pay tribute to all the guys that I learned my licks from, you know. And but normally, I just like to record my own stuff just to get the money, man, you know. But
I'll pick one from the CD for the tribute to one of the guys.
Oh, okay. Let me see.
We did a lot of talking. People are now wanting to listen to the song.
Yeah. Let me see here. I got to get in this Delta tuning, what they call the old guys. They call this the Spanish tuning. Like Muddy Waters and those guys. It's kind of like a G tune. But I tune low, a whole step low. This is probably around an F. Okay. I got this version off this is an old John Estes, old sleepy John Estes, I think originally did this song. Nobody, a lot of these old tunes, nobody really knows who did them. But it's that, but Furry Lewis did it kind of. Well, now I'm going down to Brownsville. I'm gonna take that right-hand rule. Well, now I'm going down to Brownsville. I'm gonna take that right-hand rule. You know I ain't gonna quit walking till I come up on Big Mama's door. You know the girl I've been loving, man, she got that long, dark, curly hair. I said that girl I've been loving, man, she's got that long, dark, curly hair. You know, but a mama and a daddy, they don't want me hanging around down there. You know my baby, she gonna jump and shout. Yes, she will. Now when I step down off that bus, my baby, she's gonna jump and shout. You know I'm gonna show that girl what that thing is all about. I said the folks down in Brownsville, they all know my name. Well now the folks down in Brownsville, they all know my name. You know when I get down there, they sure be glad I came. Corner, you know my feet are soaking wet. Well, now I'm standing down on the corner, my feet are soaking wet. And I ain't seen nobody. Looks like my baby, yeah. You know I ain't seen nobody. Looks like my baby, yeah. I said I ain't seen nobody. Looks like my baby, yeah.
Well, that's some music.
Thank you.
That's some music for a warm summer night with a pig on the barbecue.
Back porch music, man.
Yeah. That's what it sounds like. That's what it brings the memory of.
Yeah.
Hey, you play, you're on tour now.
They tell me.
What? Is it exhausting touring?
Nah. It's a vacation, man.
Well, some people say the touring is the hard part. The playing is easy.
Nah, man. It's
so traveling is the hard
part. I love
part.
It, man. Sometimes the band complains. I don't know. My bass player was telling me the other day. He says, man, I think you're cut out for this. You know, I said, no kidding. But I don't get tired.
Well, it's a traveling circus, you know.
Huh?
It's a traveling circus. You're from one town to another.
Yeah. Well, we have a lot of fun on tour, man, in the bus, joking around and stuff, so it's not tiring, man. It's a big laugh to me, man. You know, it's no hardship at all. I mean, we're lucky to be doing this, to tell you the truth, man. I mean, otherwise I'd be home shoveling a meter of snow, man.
You know yeah, I mean? Michigan. You have to, it's snow over there.
Yeah,
but
man.
You play a lot of different, otherwise tonight you're playing in a little small or a medium venue.
Man,
but I saw you last year, you play in a Swedish rock festival with Slash on stage.
Yeah, man. I mean, you know, it's like I'll play anywhere.
20,000 people and Michael Katon is ripping it.
Hey,
on
man.
Stage.
Hey, today I'm playing for what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Eight people, man.
Well, we limit it to 10, so.
No, man. To me, people are people. If there's one or two people there listening, that's fine with me. I don't care if it's my living room or Madison Square Garden. It don't make no difference to me, man. You know, I just like to boogie.
I like the boogie. Which certainly deserved you the nickname Boogieman from Hell.
You know where that came from?
No, that's the question I want to ask for you.
I used to do that song. I don't know if I can do it acoustic. That one, baby, baby, I'm your savior, prowling in the street. Mercy, mercy, God, the nursery ain't too young for me. Don't you know that I devour every girl I can? Only I possess the power. I'm the boogeyman. It's usually pretty loud. Mercy, mama, I'm the trauma. Down on my knees. Doctor, doctor, heal your daughter. She got my disease. Don't you know that I deflower every girl I can? Only I possess the power. I'm the boogeyman. I said I'm the boogeyman. Yeah, I'm a boogeyman, baby. I boogie every chance I can. I said I'm the boogeyman. Boogeyman. Anyway, that's where that name came from. Yeah, thank you.
Oh, but boogie is a nice kind of sort of music to play because the people are getting all psyched up.
Well, you know what it is, man. Like,
and you have to, in every CD you do, you have to put a boogie on now.
Well, it's kind of a joke now, man. If you go through my CDs, I think boogie is on there. Like, somebody mentioned, one of my old drummers, man, said like, "Hey, man, I challenge you to do a record without the word boogie in." When we were kids, we kind of used to, excuse me, but I don't know, boogie meant something different, you know, like we're going to boogie, you know. It's like just have a good time, high energy music, you know. And then people started using it like some of the English bands, like Savoy Brown would come over and they had a song called The Boogie, you know. I think they recorded some of it in Detroit off that live album theirs, because I was there one night when they were recording. I think I was there that night, man. But they used to love Detroit, man. A lot of bands love Detroit.
Motown,
just the energy there, man. You know.
Is it still? No, it isn't the town it was, because if you see something on YouTube or on TV or internet, it's Well, the crisis hit the city pretty hard, did it?
Yeah, the economic thing, man, with the car companies going down and all. It's real bad for gigs, too, man. I mean, you can go do gigs every night of the week if you feel like it, but then you're playing for nothing, you know? And it's hard to get really good musicians. Like, you know, my drummer, you know, he's Johnny B, man. He's like, you know, world famous. A lot of people don't know it, but, man, he's on a lot of hit records. If you hear, all the Mitch Ryder and Detroit Wheels, Johnny B is a drummer on all those hit records, like Devil with a Blue Dress and Sakatumi Baby and Jenny Take a Ride and all that stuff, man. He's a drummer, that guy that was sitting right there.
Is he a studio artist or?
More live, man. I mean, go to his website and there's pictures of him playing behind Ringo, you know? He's the guy you hear on, come on and take a free ride, yeah. You know, he's that drummer. Well, Alice Cooper, welcome to my nightmare, you know?
It's a Detroit guy.
Yeah. So these guys cost some money, you know, to go out and do a gig. My bass player, too, man, he's been around for a while and really good, and they cost some scratch, you know, to get them to go out and play a gig. And when, you know, you can't ask them to go play for free, you know. So the gigs are far in between because people in Detroit just don't have any money anymore to go out partying, you know.
Is the money in Europe then nowadays?
It's getting less. But, it's still pretty decent here. Well, people here, I think,
it's
you know.
Sad to hear down in the States.
You know, in the States, you're a little bit, you know, they take this stuff for granted, I think, you know, some of this music, because it's just always been there. And sometimes, I mean, if I go to a bank to get a loan, I got to send my wife in, you know. I can't be walking in there with my leather jacket and, you know, say, hey, man, give me some $20,000.
Is it the hair or is it the attitude?
Huh? they're pretty cool, but, you know, it's... you're almost a second-class citizen if you're a musician in the States, I think.
Well,
I mean, unless you're B.B. King or somebody, but
when
you're just a working musician, man, you know, we're no different than the guy out there, you know, repairing the potholes on the road, you know.
Not to us on Bluesmoose Radio.
Huh?
Do you have a gift to bring the music and joy to the people?
Well, I mean, that's another thing, too. It's like we keep doing it because, to me, man, if you got this kind of... it is a gift, you know. I mean, somebody gave it to me and they trust you or whatever, God, whoever you want to, you know, call it, they trust you with this gift. So to me, it's sinful not to go out and play, you know, if you can. You know, if I can do it, I'll be out there playing because, you know, somebody's got to do it. But
he loved a boogie in his time.
Well, you know, man, I do it because, I mean, you know, a lot of these kids, like you asked me earlier about being on the road stressful and stuff, man. I mean, to me, man, we're having a good time. You know, I'm thankful to be out on the road every day. Every gig I got, man, sitting here, man, this is, like, great for me to be doing this. And some of these younger kids are coming out complaining, oh, my hotel room's not good, you know, or I got to eat at McDonald's instead of a good meal. You know, they think they're rock stars or something. But, you know, people like Johnny, man, he's been doing it for – you know, over 50 years, the drummer.
Yeah.
I've been doing it. Somebody asked me the other day, man, like next week I'm going to be 29 years old in rock and roll years, you know. but I was born in 1953. I'll be 61 years old. And
well, you passed the 27. 27 is a difficult age in rock and roll, isn't it?
But people ask me, man, I've been doing gigs like, you know, how long you been playing? I've been doing paying gigs where I got money in my hand for playing my guitar since I was 13 years old, man. Steady, you know. So we played a lot of gigs. And people were coming up to me last night at this acoustic show, and it's in a small town, 7,000 people in the town, you know. And the guy's going, wow, man, I can't believe you came to our town. Our little tiny town, nobody knows us here. And I said, well, hell, man, you're here. You know, this guy's just as important as some guy at Swedish Rock Festival. You know what I mean? You know, if they're listening to my music and they're paying some cash to hear me, you know, we're here to boogie, man. That's all we do. You know?
Well, that's the attitude we like. If you're over 7 people, over 700.
Yeah, it don't matter to me, man.
Count 3, 2, 1, and go. That's
right, man. On your mark, get set, go.
That's why we always like to do, even the music that you didn't hear on the radio, the boogie, the what most people call the little heavy or a hard sound.
Yeah.
We say screw them. We like it, so we.
Yeah, man.
If
you
want
cool.
to play a record of 10 to 2 minutes, we do so.
And I thank you guys for keeping it going, man.
Well, and I see we go slowly to the end of this program. I can't say exactly where we are in this recording, but.
Don't matter. We're not,
we're still
blues,
time for.
We're on blues time, man.
Very still. It's time for one. So.
Oh, you know what, man? Let me see. You know, on this Bluetooth album, I got some John Lee Hooker, but. One of my songs, I'll see if I can play this acoustic. I haven't really tried it before, acoustic, but...
Would you be able to play anything if we throw it at you?
Oh, like, if you call people, one of my songs?
No, or any song, because I can remember an interview with Omar Dykes. He said we had to play...
Oh, Omar, man,
We had to play in the juke joints. He said we had to play 200-300 songs, otherwise we'd be booed off the stage.
Yeah. The other night I did a song. I can't do it in this tuning on this guitar, but we're in this small place, and they were asking for more and more and more, and I kind of went through my show and the build-up, but I said, all right, man, we're going to do a song we used to have to do in the honky-tonks, and it's the song called The Honky-Tonk, you know, Bill Doggett, you know? And, you know, these guys have been playing the same as me for 50 years, so they know it. You know, I say, hey, man, The Honky-Tonk, boo-doo-doo-doo, you know, and you start the thing. And you just know those tunes, man. You had to know them, you know, to make it out with all your teeth. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know what you mean.
I don't know if you name something. I might be able to play it. I might not, you know. Like what?
No, it's a Michael Katon show. Just has to be a Mike Katon song. Rip It Hard has to be in it today in this show. But
oh, Rip It Hard? You want Rip It Hard? Oh, man. Let me see.
Huh? Well, I don't know if it's acoustic, but that's a challenge for him.
Well, what I was going to do is...
I'll do what you want.
Well, if you want Rip It Hard, man, I gotta retune. You know, normally, this is a Stratocaster and a 100-watt Marshall song, man.
Yeah, that's it. That's why I challenge you.
All right. What's that?
I like the song because it's straight, in your face.
Yeah, Lucy.
Rip It Hard.
Woo! There it is. We don't have to be in tune on Saturday morning, do we? Today is Saturday, isn't it? Okay. Good.
No, touring isn't stressful.
Let me see. Since see my honey, been working 10 hours trying to make that money, slaving all day just to earn a dime. Now 5 o'clock and it's party time. We're gonna rip it hard, rip it hard, rip it all night long. We'll rip it hard, baby, rip it hard. Especially when you bug it on the night before. Keep my eye on the clock when I'm throwing that line. Get a big grin when you're quitting time. Rip it hard, baby. Rip it hard. Rip it all night long. Rip it hard, baby. Rip it. Rip that thing all night long. I have to get quiet now, huh? That's usually the loud part right here. Rip it hard. Thank you.
That wasn't difficult at all.
That wasn't difficult at all.
Hey, touring twice a year in Europe?
Man, I'll come as much as you have, man. But you know, lately, I didn't tour for a few years, man. I was my dad had some medical problems where he needed attention 24/7, and the only person to take care of him was me, and my wife helps out. And so I didn't do anything. I couldn't even play down at the corner pub, you know. No. I used to drive past the pub. My folks live like 5 minutes from me. We live on a lake. And in my boat in the summertime, I can get over there in about 3 minutes. And then it takes 5 minutes in the car to get there. But I had to be over at my dad's house like from maybe 7 a.m. till midnight.
Okay.
Back and forth on call during the day. I had to get him out of bed, dress him, all this kind of stuff, you know, care. So I didn't play for 3 years, you know, and then I finally arranged a tour. Yeah, my dad got a little more independent with some rehab training and stuff, and so I arranged this whole tour. And the night before the tour, which was supposed to take place in like November of 2012, I think, the night before the tour, my wife had been getting these headaches for a couple days, you know. Yeah. So the night before the tour, I get a call. And she says, hey, I'm out shopping, but my headache's so bad I can't drive or anything. So make a long story short, I took her to the emergency room, and they discovered a tumor the size of a large avocado in her brain.
So,
and they had to immediately operate. So I had to I'm in the hospital, you know, trying to text everybody and tell them I had to cancel the tour, you know. So that got canceled for another 6 months. And then in May and June, I arranged another tour. And that's when I started touring again, was just in May and June. So we'll see how it goes. Now I'm back again. So we'll see if I can get here a couple times a year. It'd be great, man.
Let's say it's great to have you back. And
well, thanks, man. It's
I'm
good to be here.
Absolutely delighted that we had you on your show. And as I see the signatures from our director, it's almost an hour, so we have completed our radio show for now.
All right, man.
Well, time flies when you're having fun.
I'm
absolutely sure that we could talk an hour and more about a lot of stuff.
Been here an hour, huh?
Yeah. It's
almost recording. Time for a coffee then, huh?
No, we'll put you a couple of water. Or a Jägermeister.
You guys got Jägermeister, man.
Yeah, we got the Jägermeister. It's our signature drink.
Well,
as
like
long
I
as
said,
we can.
Like I said earlier, you can have my share. And that's a hell of a lot. But I don't drink anymore, so you can have mine.
Now, you have seen enough of the blues. Some people say if you have to blues, you have to play the blues properly, you have to be divorced twice or three times. So you only have two tooth left and drink as hell.
Well, I might have done
the most people
stuff.
Are getting pretty
You know what the thing is?
Now.
We were saying earlier, you know, about our age and stuff, but I think that's why I'm, you know, have lived this long, because I quit like way in 1990s the last time I had to drop alcohol or cigarettes or any of that kind of stuff, you know. So that's why we're still here. Like the drummer Johnny B, you know, everybody's done this crazy stuff, but you know, he gets up in the morning, he's doing calisthenics and exercising, and he carries his own food around with him and eats it and stuff. But that's how we stay alive, to keep doing this stuff, man, you know.
I'm gonna wrap it up at last for this show.
Right.
I know we're going to take a short pause. Jebby's put another tape in, and then you play the last song that we're going to end our show with. And I can only say thank you very much, Michael Katon, to be in Bluesmoose Radio.
All right,
to see
brother.
You.
Thank you, man.
A lot of time backstage live playing the guitar as you can on 12.
Yeah. Thank you. Oh, let me see. This here's Michael Katon. You're listening to Bluesmoose Radio. Gonna catch your radio on fire if you don't be careful. Turn it up though. Crank it up. And listen to some blues. You want another one?
No, one without the whatever guitar.
Was one without
guitar.
Playing? Yeah?
Yeah.
Hey man, this is Michael Katon. You're listening to Bluesmoose Radio. Be careful. But turn it up, man. Just don't catch your radio on fire. Adios.
Okay. And, well, this is the end, Michael. Thank you for visiting Bluesmoose Radio, and it's the last song from you for our listeners.
All right, man. You know,
introduce it. Make it a Michael Katon song.
Well, what this is it's a song called Guitar for My Friend, and on this blues blues I cut my teeth on, I have a John Lee Hooker song, but it's kind of a slower one, Crawling Kingsnake. But a lot of this boogie stuff came from John Lee Hooker, you know, like especially this Detroit boogie kind of stuff. And he had a song called Hobo Blues, where he was talking about taking a freight train for his friend. And anyway, I turned it in. This is basically a true story. When I was a kid, man, I packed up the car and I went to Los Angeles on my own. I just drove across the country and looking for the golden sack of gold, you know, in the music world. But anyway, this is kind of a John Lee Hooker version of When I was just a boy, my daddy gave me a guitar to be my friend. Yeah, when I was just a boy, my daddy gave me a guitar to be my friend. He said, son, this world would let you down, but that guitar will stick with you right to the end. Yeah. I said, the day I left for Cali, my mama laid in bed all day crying. Yeah, she did, man. I said, the day I left for Cali, my mama laid in bed all day crying. My daddy said, son, I know you gotta play your guitar. I just hope you don't die trying. Out on the road, my best years are long gone, man. Yeah. Said I've been years out on the road, my best days are long gone. This whole world did let me down, man, but this guitar never did. My daddy, he wasn't wrong. Yeah, I got a guitar for my friend. Got a guitar for my friend. Yeah, I got a guitar for my friend.
That's it.
That's it.
Thanks for the people who are here, Michael Katon, Ruud List, for providing the guitar for you.
Yeah, man. Thank you, brother.
On a very short notice.
Yeah, thank you, brother. I appreciate it, man.
Our foreign guest, Joachim.
All right.